Do you know that the Christian journey is a war, a spiritual war? And are you equipped to fight this war? My name is Ernest Wamboy and you're watching Sitam Church Online. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 6 verse 12 that we do not fight against flesh and blood, but we fight against principalities, against powers, against rulers of this present darkness, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly realms. And how do we fight these levels of demonic powers? And we looked at the different levels of these demonic powers last week, and we saw that they've got power, they've got forces, they've got influence. We saw that they are those who entice, they're those who master, they're those who are world rulers, and those who are spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places, in the sky, above the sky. And we saw that these ethereal spirits are fighting against us, the believers. How do we ensure that we overcome them? Well, the Bible tells us how. It says in Ephesians 6:13-18, "Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all that, to stand." And we're told what the full armor of God is. "Stand therefore, having guarded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to the end with all perseverance and supplication for the saints." Now, when we look at this scripture, we are armed with seven things to fight the evil spirits that fight against us in the spiritual war. We are given seven things to use in the battlefield as we use the power that God has given us through His Son Jesus Christ on the cross to win the kingdom of God, to win against the kingdom of Satan through the power of the kingdom of God. Now, the first thing we are told that every believer should have is the belt of truth. What is the belt of truth? The belt of truth is the authentic message of the gospel. It is the truth that brings salvation. It is the truth that brings hope and life to every one of us. And we must have that truth guarded around our waist. It is the one that holds us together. It is the message of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ said in John 14:6, "I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life." Jesus Christ must be put on. His message, His gospel, must hold us together. We are told in the book of Colossians that Christ is the one who holds us together. In the battlefield, the belt used to hold the tunic so that the soldier, the Roman soldier, whose armor is exemplified in this text, would not have the rest of their armor fall off. It held his armor together. It held his tunic together. The gospel is what holds us together. The gospel is what enables us to stand firm in this battlefield, that we not be caught with our pants down, so to speak. So what are we fighting when we put on the belt of truth? We are fighting deception and lies. The lies that come from the father of lies. The lies that come from Satan and his demons. The things that he says to counter the truth. All those lies that tell men that they can be saved through other ways apart from the Lord Jesus Christ. All those ways that tell men they can be okay with God through other ways. All those lies that cheat men that they can be okay with their sin and not repent. We fight that the gospel, with the belt of truth, starting in ourselves and then others out there. Secondly, we are told the breastplate of righteousness. What is this breastplate of righteousness? Now, the breastplate was worn on the torso area. It was to protect the vital organs, the heart, the liver, the kidneys, those vital organs of your body. And the breastplate is the righteousness of Christ that has been imputed on the believer. The believer does not have a righteousness of his own. The believer cannot please God using their own standards. But Jesus Christ is the only one who has pleased God by living a perfectly, purely, sinless life here on earth. And by doing that, He has given us freely, by grace, without any merit, He has given us that righteousness. It is now ours. That once we believe the gospel, once we accept Jesus Christ as Lord, and we accept His death and sacrifice on the cross and His resurrection, we get His righteousness imputed on us. What does that mean? God looks at us as if we never sinned. God looks at us as if we never failed. And because of that, we are considered righteous. And we put on that righteousness. Now, Once we put on that righteousness, the grace of God is upon us, and it enables us to live a righteous life. It enables us to choose good and say no to evil. It enables us to say yes to righteousness. The Bible says in Titus 2, 11 to 12, that the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness, no to worldly passions, to live a self-controlled, upright, and godly life in this present age. You are able to say no to sin because you've got the righteousness of Christ imputed on you, because it empowers you to live a spirit-filled life, saying no to sin. So what are you fighting here? You're fighting guilt, you're fighting shame, and you're fighting the accusation of Satan. He is the accuser of the brethren, we saw in Revelation chapter 12, verse 10. But you can overcome him with the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And in the book of Revelation chapter 12, we are told that the saints overcame the devil by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. It is the righteousness of Jesus Christ that overcomes the accusations of Satan. The accusations of all your past sins, that is a spiritual war you're fighting. When you're reminded over and over of the things you did in the past, when thoughts come to your mind, that is a spiritual war. Fight. Remember who you are in Christ. Remember that your sins are forgiven. Remember that Jesus Christ has offered his blood freely on the cross for you to be saved, not by anything you've done, but freely by his grace. And receive the forgiveness, receive the grace to overcome sin, and you'll have the breastplate of righteousness. Thirdly, we are told, put on the shoes of readiness of the gospel of peace. Now, shoes are necessary in a war so that your feet don't get pricked. And the Roman shoe used in the war had spikes at the bottom of it, and they'd step onto the ground and have a firm grip on it. They wouldn't slip. The shoes of the readiness of the gospel of peace do the same thing for us, that when we share the gospel, we have a firm stand in our faith. Just as the Romans had spikes on their shoes to hold them, that they may stand firm, the gospel of Jesus Christ enables us to stand firm in our faith. What is this? This is the Great Commission. When you go out there and share the gospel, you are encouraged in your faith. You are strengthened in your faith. When you see Jesus Christ bring salvation to other people, you are strengthened. Those spikes hold you firm. You do not slip. When you have people look up to you because you are a believer and you share the gospel to them, you stand firm. You have your faith fixed because the shoes are holding firmly onto the ground. And we are told that the shoes of the readiness of the gospel of peace bring peace to men. They tell them that God no longer has his anger and wrath against us because that wrath and anger has been taken out against Christ. What are you fighting? You're fighting ignorance. You're fighting people who do not know the truth of the gospel. You're fighting the deception that is against the souls that are deceived. And these people who are ignorant are brought into the saving truth of the gospel, and the demonic forces behind them are rendered useless when we evangelize to these lost souls. And then finally, number four, the shield of faith. What is the shield of faith? The shield of faith is the precious promises of God. The Romans had a shield that they used in the battlefield that they called a scutum. The scutum was almost the length of the entire body, and it protected them from all the flaming arrows that would come their way. How do they do that? They would take their shield, dip it in water, and whenever the enemy would fire arrows against them, these arrows had pitch on them. These arrows would come and strike the shield, but they would be extinguished because the shield was wet, the shield was damp, and the fire from the arrows would not bring down the enemies, and they would advance all the way to the end. Despite the resistance they faced, they would still advance because their shield was sure. We have been told that we can advance in our faith. We can advance in our battle, in the spiritual battle. Why? Because of faith. Faith will extinguish the flaming arrows of Satan. The fear, the worry, the doubt, the anxiety that he brings our way, he fires against us. Because our shield is up and strong, we shall overcome him. The Bible says, "Thou, O Lord, art a shield about us, our glory and the lift of our head." God gives us that shield of faith. We are told without faith it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who diligently seek him. That by putting up that faith we are able to please God and we are able to advance. Now, I believe the Roman shield being dipped in water is significant of us having our faith dipped in the water of the word. That our faith is not based on empty promises. Our faith is not based on empty carnal desires. Our faith is not based on empty sinful patterns. Our faith is based on what God says in his word. And so the shield of faith will work when you start claiming and proclaiming the word of God over your life. The promises that he's made to you. What are those promises? Investigate the word of God. You're fighting doubt. You're fighting unbelief. Claim the promises of God. Take up the shield of faith and fight. Next, we are told the helmet of salvation. The Romans wore a helmet that had a specific red marking over the top of it to identify them in the battlefield. When you had your helmet on, you are known as a Roman soldier or a Greek soldier or a Persian soldier. And the Romans had a very unique helmet that let them know that they belong to the Roman army. The helmet of salvation is also meant to identify us as Christians, that this is who we are, that we are identified on this planet as those who've received the salvation of our God, that our primary identity is Christian. Our primary identity is not Kenyan, is not male, is not female, is not anything else, is not educated. Our primary identity is saved, salvation. And the helmet of salvation identifies us. The helmet of salvation gives us identity. The helmet of salvation helps us to be sober, to have our minds, our thoughts set right in the identity that is given to us by God. That we are not swayed away by other identities. We are not swayed away by other winds of doctrine. We are fighting false teaching. We are fighting false identities. We are fighting things that try and dissuade us as believers. And we are watching our life and our doctrine to understand that our primary responsibility and our primary identity is to be called sons of God, forgiven by the blood, forgiven by God the Father through the blood of Jesus Christ. The next one is the sword of the Spirit. And we're told the sword of the Spirit is the word of God. What is its function? The Bible tells us in Hebrews 4:12 that the word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword, able to separate soul and joints and marrow, soul and spirit, judging the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. In the spiritual war, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, is able to ensure that we are living right, to be able to tear down the lies of Satan, and to judge the thoughts and attitudes that we have. We're told in 2 Corinthians chapter 10 that the strongholds of Satan are normally raised up, but we bring them down using the word of God. That every thought and argument that is raised up above the knowledge of the word of God can be brought down. How? Using the sword of the Spirit. Now you'll understand that in the full armor of God, the only offensive part of this armor is the sword. And the sword is sharp. The sword can cut. All the others seem to be defensive, but the sword is able to offend. Now, the word of God offends us. It offends our sin. It offends us in our comfort. It afflicts those who are comfortable, and it comforts those who are afflicted. And you must understand why it is a sword. A sword is a very skilled, is a very unique instrument. It needs one who is skilled. It needs you to be trained. It needs you to be set. It needs you to practice. And for us to be those who can handle the sword of the Spirit, just like an ordinary swordsman, we need practice with the word of God. We need to train. We need to read, hear, study, memorize, meditate the word of God, that we may be able to fight the enemy, fight the lies and the deceptions he brings our way by tearing them down. And finally, the final weapon we are given is prayer, communication with God, prayer. Even in the battlefield, the soldiers speak to their commander. They receive instructions from him. They speak back to him. They tell him this is what is going on, and the commander sends them instructions. Similarly, in our battlefield, we need to communicate with our Creator. We need to pray. We need to speak. He needs to direct us to go to the right, to go to the left, to lift up our shields, to put down our shields, to cut through, to penetrate through, to go forcefully, to go slowly. The Romans received the instructions from their commander, and our commander is Jesus Christ. Similarly, we need to receive those instructions from God, and we need to give him back the things that we have in our hearts. And that is prayer. Prayer is communication with God. And the way to fight, this is to literally set aside time and do it and pray. That there's no other way to do it but to actually set aside time and pray. You fight the spiritual war when you take time and you go before the Lord, claim his promises and speak to him, and be assured that when we pray to God, he will answer us. God will not answer those unspoken prayers. We need to be vigilant in the battlefield and say we'll fight our pride, because prayer is dependent on God. No soldier in the battlefield ever survives by thinking he will not communicate with his commander, that he will survive on his own. That is a proud soldier. He will be wounded. But a humble soldier keeps looking to his commander and keeps looking for instructions, and he commands, he receives the commands and he obeys them, and he gives the feedback back to the commander. He is the same for us. We need to receive commands from God, and we need to speak to him. We need to pray. That will make us humble. That will make us tender of heart. That will make us dependent on him, and we can be sure the fight against sin in our lives, any addiction, any struggle, any family problems can be won successfully, and ultimately the souls of men, the salvation of those brothers and sisters, family members who want to be born again, can be won if you take up the full armor of God and stand. Thank you very much for watching. My name is Ernest Wamboe, and if this video has blessed you, leave a like, leave a comment, share it with your friends and family. And we are so glad you could join us in this series. Until next time, I will see you around.